Manhood, hashtag Me Too, Dr. King, and Bobby Kennedy. And our speaker is Kevin Powell, who is one of the most acclaimed political, cultural, literary, and hip-hop voices in America today. He's the product of a single mother, an absent father, violence, and horrific poverty. But he was able to study at Rutgers University in his home state of New Jersey due to a full financial aid package and against great odds. So Kevin has gone on to become a writer who's worked for a wide range of newspapers and magazines and websites. They include the New York Times, Washington Post, CNN, NPR, Essence, Ebony, Rolling Stone, you name it, he's probably written for it. Okay. And most recently, he wrote a British GQ cover story on the Black Panther movie co-star Michael B. Jordan, and currently hosts an Apple podcast called One-on-One with Kevin Powell. He's the author of 13 books, including his critically acclaimed autobiography, The Education of Kevin Powell, and come back on Thursday, September 6th for that. Yes. His 14th book will be a biography of Tupac Shakur, who Kenneth interviewed many times while working for Vibe. So I'm not going to say any more. But I think one of the most important things about Kevin is he's married to Jenna Parker. Yeah. And she was here on Sunday, June 3rd. One of our members, Sarah, interviewed her, and it was a lovely interview. And so now we're really looking forward to hearing from you as well, Kevin. So come on up.
Good morning. How are you all doing? I want to apologize first and foremost, and I hope you forgive me for being late. I literally got in from California at 8 a.m., and I had to rush home to Brooklyn from JFK and get ready for this. So can you forgive me, please, for being late? And it's interesting, Sister Ann, and I want to thank Sister Ann, Sister Margaret, all the wonderful people here at New York Society for Ethical Culture. I love this space. Can I just say that? Can we just give you all a round of applause? Just thank you. Thank you. As you were speaking about all the things that we need to do in this world, this new revolution, part of the reason why I was in California, two reasons I was in California, one was for Jenna, because I work for Jenna. I'm clear that women are the real leaders on the planet, and we're gonna be bringing She out to the West Coast at some point next year to Los Angeles. And the other reason why I was out there is because I just became a co-producer on a upcoming biopic on the life and times of Frederick Douglass, who I'm sure everyone has heard of, which is really exciting, and it's a big deal, and we're working hard on it because Frederick Douglass, as you all know, embodied everything that you just laid out. And two things that stood out to me as I've been thinking about Frederick Douglass in the last couple of weeks. One, he was the most photographed American in the 19th century, which I did not know, even more so than Abraham Lincoln and other folks. Number two, and I think many of you know this already, he was one of the first men, American men, to support women's rights and full equality for women in this country. So hashtag Me Too, as we know, was happening in the 1800s as well. And then lastly, I did not know that his wife, his first wife, he was married to two women. His first wife was African American, his second wife was a white American sister. And as you know, Frederick Douglass was biracial, so he always said that, hey, I married, you know, both parts of me in my lifetime. But his first wife, Anna, was actually a free black woman, I did not know this, in the city of Baltimore. She was a successful businesswoman who could not read or write. She met Frederick Douglass, they fell in love, and she helped him to escape from slavery. That's a part of the story that's often not highlighted, and so that's gonna be a part of this film, so I'm really excited about it. So just thank you for having me here. I wanna acknowledge, who's a father or father figure out there in some form or fashion? Let's give them a round of applause. You know, happy Father's Day. Happy Parents Day. And you know, as Ann said in my introduction, and I'm gonna talk about this a bit, this topic, you know, fatherhood, manhood, hashtag Me Too, Dr. King, and Bobby Kennedy. I'm gonna attempt to talk about all of this in one speech. But there's a reason why I said all these things, because fatherhood, manhood, hashtag Me Too, Dr. King, and Bobby Kennedy have been really deeply on my mind and my heart this year. First thing I need to say, I want to acknowledge that there are good men in our communities. There are good men out there in the country that are doing good work. I just need to acknowledge that, because a lot of times, we need to acknowledge that. I hope that I'm a good man. I hope that Jenna said I was a good man when she was here a couple weeks ago. At least that she feels that way. I'm doing my best. But I have to be honest about it. Father's Day for me is a melancholy day, because the first example of fatherhood, the first example of manhood that I ever had in my life was my own biological father. And he simply was never there. He was never there. My mother and two of her sisters migrated from South Carolina back in the 1960s. My mother and the two sisters literally got to the North Jersey, New York area in early 1964. And because they were from a rural area, they were poor. They were very, very poor. We literally come from poverty. And she actually thought there was an outer space invasion happening because she kept hearing, the Beatles are coming, the Beatles are coming, the Beatles are coming. So they literally got to the New York area at the same time that the Beatles came to America. And my mother was freaked out by that. Then she realized, oh, they actually sing. These are not aliens. But my mother met my father. My mother fell deeply in love with my father. My mother was about 21, 22 years old at the time. My father was already in his early 30s. He was a truck driver. He had money. He actually had a house. He had property, the whole nine, in Jersey City, where I eventually be born. She fell in love with him. He fell in lust with her. I was conceived. And my father was barely around after that. And so my mother literally, when it was time to give birth to me, had to take herself to the hospital, taxi cab. And so this is my introduction. I saw my father between the time I was born and the first 8 years of my life, maybe two or three times in total. I remember the first time, you know, it was because my mother called, reached out, can you help us, can you help us? He bought me my first watch. Do y'all remember Timex watches? Remember Timex takes a licking and keeps on ticking? Remember those things? He bought me my first bicycle. I remember being because he was a truck driver, as I said, I remember him putting me in his truck to ride with him, and my father being the kind of man we're going to talk about today, which is toxic manhood. Unfortunately, there was pictures of nude women all over the truck, and I was a 5 or 6 year old boy looking at all this stuff. And that was the first introduction to him. I hung out with him a couple more times. You know, he took a few pictures of me. I have pictures of my father, not with him, never took a single picture with my father. I have a few pictures that he took of me because he had a Polaroid camera. And other than that, one rainy day when I was 8 years old, I'll never forget it. We didn't have poverty, Sister Ann, you know, boy, do I know poverty. I didn't know there was color TV growing up. I didn't know we could have a telephone in our home growing up. I had one pair of shoes and one pair of sneakers when I was growing up. And if you ran a hole into your shoes or sneakers, you put cardboard or newspapers in the bottom of your shoes or sneakers. I come from what she described as horrific poverty, you know. And this is one reason why I don't like terms in these times like ghetto or hood or trailer trash or poor white trash. Anything that seems to be classless and disrespectful to people who come from poor backgrounds. How many of y'all saw a movie that I think is incredible? I just watched it on a plane coming back from California called Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. Did anyone see that movie? Is that not an incredible film? I mean, this is a film set in rural, poor, small town America. And I empathize with folks who come from those backgrounds. I don't care if you're white, black, Latino, Latina, Asian, Native American, straight, queer, it doesn't matter to me. Poverty, to me, is a form of violence. And this is what I was forced to grow up in. And this day, when I was 8 years old, my mother wasn't the kind of person that's gonna say, I'm gonna take you for child support or anything like that. But my father had been baiting her on. You know, she would tell me later, I'm gonna marry you, then I'm not gonna marry you, then I'm gonna marry you, then I'm not gonna marry you. We go to the drugstore where there was a phone booth. My mother's in the phone booth, and it's a rainy day, as I said, and she would tell me later that she asked her father again, my father, can you help us? Can you help us? Can you help us? And on this particular day, my father said to my mother, you lied to me. He's not my son, and I'm not gonna give you a near nickel for him ever again, and hung up the phone on her. And near nickel, I didn't know what a near nickel was. I know what a nickel was, but not a near nickel. But he was a Southerner like my mother, so this is one of the phrases that he had brought with him up to the North. And my mother was devastated by it. And so I want you all to think about this for a second, particularly you all who are fathers or father figures or mentors or coaches or educators or anyone who identifies as a male. You know, the impact that you have on not just boys, but also girls or any gender identity when you abandon children. As Ann said, my next book is a biography of Tupac Shakur. For a lot of people, Tupac for us is Bob Dylan. Tupac for us is Laura Nero, is Carole King, is Bob Marley, is Marvin Gaye. Tupac in his short 25 years on this planet, his constant quest was for a father figure. That's why he had a lot of really profound associations, which I'll talk about in the book. My mother was devastated. She is she's still alive, but a poor black woman from the South. So she had to deal her entire life up to that point and after that as well with racism, with sexism, and with classism. Are y'all with me out there? You know, and there was no Oprah. There were no meditation circles. There was no yoga classes that I go to. There was no Reiki healing. There was none of that. There was no great spaces like this wonderful space at Ethical. I love this space. You know, this is a beautiful space because I see this as a healing space. And we need healing spaces. Would you not agree in this country? Many of us don't have it. My mother didn't have it. And so can you imagine someone who was born in 1943, she'll be 75 in August, on August 28th. She literally turned 20 years old when the March on Washington happened back in 63. She grew up in Jim Crow America. And so there was no healing. You just had to take in the racism, take in the sexism, take in the classism. When I started seeing women like my friend Annabella Sciorra, my friend Tarana Burke, who coined the term hashtag Me Too, speaking out over the last 6-7 months, it made me think about a story my mother told me when I was a child. And I don't know why she told it to me. She was working in the home of a wealthy white family in Westchester County. The family was gone, but the husband, the father was there. Father's Day. The father was there. And he came out in a robe, and there was nothing under the robe, and he sat there. And she never even told me how she was able to get out of that situation, to be really blunt about it, without getting raped, without getting sexually assaulted in some form. You know, this is what she had to deal with. And so a lot of the hurt that my mother experienced from my father, that she experienced from our society, America, I'm an only child, so you can imagine who it was taken out on. Violence, abuse, emotional abuse, verbal abuse. Don't be like your father. You're just like your father. Don't be like your father. You're just like your father. And I say to you all, as women out there who identify as women, I cannot imagine what it's like to be a woman. I have no idea. I have no idea. You know, but I think about mothers that I know since my mother who have had safe spaces like this, Sister Ann, who have said they made conscious decisions because they had the formal education or they self-education to understand that if you put all of this that happened with you and the male figure on the child is going to be messed up as well. So it started in my household. You know, a lot of stuff that I ended up going through years later, years of therapy, started in my household. But my father and the patriarchy and the racism and the classism of the society, I feel, damaged my mother, and it was literally passed to me. Are y'all with me out there? So when I think about Father's Day, and I don't mean to damper the mood here, but I think that we have to have an honest conversation about where we are. When I was watching Three Billboards outside Ebbing, Missouri, and I'm watching Frances McDormand's character and how she's challenging the patriarchy of that society, this small town, I said, this is the kind of courage that we need. Would y'all agree with that? It wasn't just what my father did, the first example of manhood or fatherhood, gone, abandoned. You can imagine the father hole that I felt from 8 years old going forward. You know, it's deep to me now because I work with a lot of younger men that I admire greatly. You know, Brother Ben Weitz is here, Brother Kevin Donahoe is here. You know, men that are my peers, like Brother Dave, say your last name for me.
Rudbar.
I always say his name wrong. Brother Dave. But men that I admire, my generation and younger, you know, but I also remember how many years it took me to be able to have a human relationship with a man because of what happened with my father disappearing. You know, being able to say, you know, have honest, open conversations, how it was difficult for me to even accept the fact that someone was trying to help me, trying to mentor me. I remember as a young man how many men I pushed away because I simply had no idea and there was no trust there. Are y'all with me? Yeah. But it's just not just the immediate experience that affects you when you think about fatherhood and manhood. What is a man? What is a man? What is a man? Well, the definitions that we get from school. I mean, as I was walking here from the subway station, you know, I saw two boys, young boys, with their parents celebrating Father's Day, and the boys were doing what I did when I was a little boy. They were preparing to fight. And if you are socialized as a heterosexual, cisgendered male, from the time you're a little boy, you're taught that boys fight. And if you don't fight, we throw out homophobic, transphobic terms toward these boys. We all did it. That's what I did. It was done to us. It was like a male policing that goes on. You're somehow weak if you cry, if you express emotion, if you don't want to play sports, if you happen to be into the arts. Well, guess what? I love sports. I grew up playing sports, baseball, running track. I played every sport you can imagine. But no one knew I wanted to be a writer from the time I was about 11 years old because that's not something that boys are supposed to do because that represents sensitivity. Are y'all with me out there? You know, and this is, when you think about what we were educated, how we were educated around American history, and I've been blessed, Sister Anna, to visit all 50 states in this country as a speaker, as an activist, and I don't take that for granted because I didn't even get on a plane until I was 24 years ago, half my life ago, basically. You know, and one of the things that I see across the country is that, you know, whether we went to public schools or private schools, unless we have parents like the parents that Ben has, like the parents that Brother Kevin has, who are worldly people, who will make sure that they're exposed to all kinds of people, all kinds of cultures, Guess what, you all? Most of us who are socialized as fathers and men see masculinity, manhood, around conquering and domination and, you know, war and bloodshed. Y'all with me out there? And so when I think about how I was socialized, I mean, you know, the lie that Columbus discovered America, many of the lies about the so-called founding fathers and how it's conveniently left out about slavery for all these folks. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, this whole exploring of the country and settling land as if the indigenous people, Native Americans, were not in Manhattan first, not in Manhattan first. Are y'all with me out there? Manhattan means land of many hills. Or we're told these lies about how the Native Americans here in Manhattan just sold it for, what was it, $26 worth of trinkets? $24. No, you know, but what we were really being taught as men and women is that this is what manhood is. It's rugged, it's adventurous, it's conquering, it's domination. And it's not just the schools. I mean, when I went to church, it's the same thing. I mean, schools, and women, y'all know this, the schools left out from kindergarten to the 12th grade, I was an A student. In 13 years of school, I learned that Betsy Ross sewed a flag. I learned vaguely about Harriet Tubman, and I thought it was a real railroad that she had. I thought it was like a real train, not the, you know, the Underground Railroad. Helen Keller, but they didn't really explain to you the depths of how incredible Helen Keller was as a human being. Eleanor Roosevelt, minimalized. Y'all know what I'm talking about. And Rosa Parks. Maybe five or six women in my entire education, then I go to college. Church, my religious institution, you know, and we know there are progressive churches out there, there are progressive synagogues out there, progressive masjids, temples of all kinds, but unfortunately, the ones that I went to, everything was male-centered, male-dominated. In fact, if you were a woman, you were not allowed to be in the pulpit in the churches. They told women how they could and could not dress. You certainly couldn't be a preacher or a pastor. Y'all know what I'm talking about out there. You know, as if that your voices didn't matter. And so I'm watching all this as a 5-year-old, 6-year-old, 10-year-old. It's not just school or church, but it's TV, it's movies. My favorite show growing up as a kid was two shows I loved, I Dream of Jeannie and Happy Days. I didn't think about it as a child, but the phenomenon of a woman in a bottle calling a man master, genie. I love Henry Winkler. I love the Fonz. But the fact that he could just snap his fingers and women would just fly out of the woodworks. But imagine what that's doing to your psyche as a male, that women are caretakers and sexual objects, and that's it. It wasn't just there. I mean, the books that I read, I knew I wanted to be a writer because I stumbled into Ernest Hemingway when I was 11 years old, a wonderful book called For Whom the Bell Tolls. But when I think about it, K through 12, Emily Dickinson was pretty much the only woman writer that I had, other than S.E. Hinton, who wrote The Outsiders, and we didn't find out until after the fact, that was a woman, do you know what I mean? And so I also didn't think that women created anything. No math, no science, no literature, nothing. Are y'all with me? And then there's the men in the community. You know, I don't want to step on any toes, but I'm very conscious of how I relate to Brother Ben, how I relate to Brother Kevin. These are young men. They have fathers, of course, you know, but I also see myself as a father figure now. And I think about how there's even older men that I was just with in California, you know, who are at the age of my mother, who are still telling ridiculous, sexist, perverted jokes. Well, that just didn't start today. When I was a boy, there were grown men in the community who would say things to us, father figures, that if you want to get some hair in your chest, if you want to get some facial hair, this is what you have to do to the girls in the community. Just think about this. We're basically encouraging what we call rape culture. So for me, Father's Day and manhood are intertwined, and it's a time to really reassess, who are we? How do we define fatherhood? How do we define manhood? And why are all these women over the last 8, 9, 10 months saying hashtag me too? And not just famous women, women of all backgrounds. As Sister Ann said, Jenna was just here a couple weeks ago. Her cast has a multicultural cast of women. A multicultural crew of women come to see the show. So many have said over and over again, hashtag me too. It says to me that part of the problem is how we define manhood. And it's, in my opinion, should be called toxic manhood. Toxic manhood. When I was a teenager, early teens, there was a young woman in our community. I don't even remember her name. I'm embarrassed to admit that I don't know her name, but they called her, us boys in the community, Hori Dori. Why was she called Hori Dori? Because someone put out the notion, whether it was fact or fiction, that she had had sex or did something sexual with boys in the community. Therefore, she must be Hori Dori. But meanwhile, the boys can do it, no names. I get to college, Rutgers University. I love my school. I was told first week or two at Rutgers University, there's so much sex happening at this university, there's no need for electricity to keep the lights on. This was said to me by males. I'm green. I'm barely out of virginity. I mean, like, barely. I'm not proud of it. First party I went to at Rutgers University, one of my friends was dancing with a young lady. He had already had sex with her, and he said, Kev, you dance with her, you take her now. I just followed the rules. I didn't know what I was doing. This young lady, she died a couple years ago of cancer, and I always wished that I had the opportunity to apologize to her because of how so many boys on that campus just thought she was just a sexual object, a piece of meat. Do y'all know what I'm saying? I was set up by my father, by the men and boys around me, by the time I got to my early 20s, for toxic manhood. I'm living in Brooklyn, first woman I lived with. We get into an argument a few months into the relationship. Violence was a solution for me. I had already been violent towards all genders as a young man. This is 1991. She said something I didn't like. I pushed her into a bathroom door. She ran out of the apartment. I remember standing there trembling, July 1991. To her credit, because she didn't have to do it, and to the credit of people in the community, folks said to me, look, man, how can you talk all this new revolution stuff and you're helping to oppress half the world's population as a man with your toxic manhood? You need to get help. But what does that help mean for us fathers, for men? Some of us, it might mean therapy, very serious therapy. And I'm glad that I've been in it for years and years and years and never engaged in that kind of behavior again. For some of us, it might mean, you know what? We need to get into some circles with men. Women do it all the time. Brother Dave knows what I'm talking about. He does it all the time. Coach Dave, look him up, follow him on social media. He works consistently with men. Like, we have to open up, we have to talk. We have to talk about what's hurting us. And what I realized, Sister Ann and everyone here, I have been carrying around all this trauma, all this pain from my childhood years, and now I'm taking it out on people in my adult life. Are y'all with me out there? And so what does it matter if we're celebrating Father's Day and you're there physically and you can say, well, I pay the bills and I make sure that the kids are fed and things are running well, but you're emotionally damaged. You're spiritually damaged. Are y'all with me? When I look at Harvey Weinstein and Bill Cosby, both can say they've done a lot for a lot of people, but look at the damage that they did because they never took care of themselves. You can't hide behind status symbols. You can't hide behind careers. You can't hide behind money. If you're damaged, you're damaged, and eventually it will come back up in horrific ways, drugging people, drugging women, and raping them. You know, when I think of Annabella Sciorra, who I've known for years, one of the things I always thought about was, like, this woman is a dynamic actress. What happened to her career? But then when this all came out last fall, I said, wow, she basically had her whole career sabotaged. Not only was she raped, but her whole career was sabotaged after that. She was, in a sense, she was raped twice. Women said to me, like Bell Hooks, like Eve Ensler, like Gloria Steinem, like the late, great Audre Lorde, men, we need to own our past. We need to own our mistakes. If you need help, you need to get help. And you need to make a commitment, a commitment, a commitment to healing. And we gotta be serious about what Brother Dave is doing, redefining manhood. And it can't just be us coming around women and girls. It has to be us having the courage to work with men and boys. Are y'all with me out there? Yeah. That's what it has to be. And understanding that there's not a single male, quote unquote, in this society who has not been affected by patriarchy, sexism, and misogyny at some point in time? All of us. All of us. How does it apply to my father? My father, when I think about Father's Day, the first thing I do every Father's Day, I go and call my mother, a single woman, and say, Happy Father's Day. Because she had to take on both roles to raise me by herself. How does it apply to my father? I had to realize years later that my father was raised in the same society that we're describing. He simply was acting out the script that he was given from the time he was a little boy. See my mother as nothing more than a sexual object, take her virginity, get her pregnant, not be there when I'm born, kick us to the curb when I'm 8 years old, completely gone. This is why we come to Dr. King and Bobby Kennedy for me. I'm gonna wrap it up here. I admire Kevin's father. I admire Ben's father. I admire, again, all the men that are here. And I was one of those young men, and even as an older man, I look for manhood and examples of positive, healthy manhood and fatherhood for men around me. Do y'all know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? And some of those folks I look for examples from happen to be in history. When I was coming up in college, I'm not gonna lie to you all, and I still to this day consider Malcolm X my greatest hero, but what I did ignorantly when I was a younger man, emotionally, spiritually, I rejected Dr. King as I was embracing Martin Luther King. You know why I rejected Martin Luther King? Because he talked about love, which is insane. That I rejected him because he talked about love. Because as we can tell, we need love in this world. But I said in my mind, because I still was inculcated with toxic masculinity, toxic manhood, toxic fatherhood, that if a man is talking about love, there must be something wrong with them. Wow. You know what brought me back to Dr. King? If you all remember, in the early 1990s, Spike Lee did a film called Malcolm X. And there's all these folks who jumped on the Malcolm X bandwagon, and a lot of folks knew nothing about Malcolm X. And I was mad about the fact that these folks don't listen to his speeches the way I do. And I was just some young, arrogant person thinking that I knew everything about Malcolm X, no one else did. But then I realized, Kevin, you don't know anything about Dr. King other than the Montgomery bus boycott, the March on Washington, and he's dead. Who was this man? We know that Dr. King was a very human being. I mean, there's allegations of plagiarism around his PhD. Doesn't mean he wasn't a great human being. We know that he smoked cigarettes. We know that there was many extramarital affairs. But we also know that this man had integrity when it came to this new revolution. For example, when he won the Nobel Peace Prize in 64, in his early 30s, he took all the money he got from the Nobel Peace Prize. And because he did not want to appear to be pimping as a man, as many people do, people around him, y'all know what I'm talking about, those ministers and rabbis and imams and elected officials whose careers are solely based on pimping the people, Dr. King put every dime that he got from the Nobel Peace Prize back into the civil rights movement. That caught my attention, because I didn't know that. Then what also caught my attention was the point that Ann raised earlier. He started shifting away from civil rights, because we got Civil Rights Bill in 64, the Voting Rights Act in 65. He started talking about poverty, about class issues. He started talking about the war in Vietnam, how we're sending poor blacks and poor whites and poor yellow people, poor Asian sisters and brothers in a place called Vietnam. I said, well, this is the Dr. King that I'm interested in, because if I'm gonna find some new examples of fatherhood, some new examples of manhood, what I'm getting from Dr. King is that part of this journey of manhood is that you have to evolve. You cannot stay stuck in the same place for the rest of your life. Are y'all with me out there? You gotta be courageous enough to go against the grain. If some folks are going, everyone's going this way, but you see something else, you gotta go with that. You know? Dr. King said, a riot is the language of the unheard. It was Dr. King who said in 1967, that Vietnam War speech, April 4, 1 year to the day he was killed, that we were moving in 67 from a people-oriented society, a person-oriented society, to a thing-oriented society. That was before iPhones, y'all. This is 50 years ago. It was Dr. King who said we needed a radical redistribution of wealth, a radical revolution of our values. I'm paraphrasing it. And I said, there's something there. And I studied Dr. King's death in a different way. I studied the mountaintop speech in a very different way. I realized that this man was giving literally his own eulogy when he gave that mountaintop speech. And somehow or another, in studying Dr. King in a different way, I came across Robert Francis Kennedy in a very different way. I only knew him basically as John's little brother. We all knew about John F. Kennedy. Well, who is Bobby Kennedy? Like Dr. King came from privilege. But the thing is, Dr. King didn't have privilege when he died. Dr. King died broke. He might have had three or four suits, but his life was rich in other ways, and we know he was not about status. This man with a PhD was in Memphis, Tennessee when he was killed, working with garbage workers, sanitation workers, because he understood there was dignity in all work. Bobby Kennedy was considered arrogant in his younger years. He was considered the bully of the family. He was the youngest boy. He was kind of considered a runt by the rest of the family. You know, he was little, Bobby, right? And we know that there was accusations of nepotism when Bobby was appointed attorney general under his brother in 1961. But then as we know, and I have no memory of it, but when we think about it, just like 9-1-1 will be seared into our consciousness for the rest of our lives, well, John Kennedy getting killed in 1963 is seared into our consciousness of this country for the rest of our lives, whether we were alive or not. And Bobby, who was resistant up until that point as attorney general, sometimes he supported black and white civil rights workers working in the South together. Sometimes he did not support. He moved slow. There were people who accused him in New York City, not far from where we are right now. Major black figures like Nina Simone, like James Baldwin, like Harry Belafonte, that Bobby is out of touch with this country. But then his brother gets killed. And Bobby developed two things that he would carry with him as a man, as a father figure for the rest of his life. Compassion and empathy. And when he came back publicly in 64 and became a senator for our state of New York, in those last 4 years of his life, I mean, you know, as I said to Brother Kevin, you know, because I got big plans for Ben and Brother Kevin. These are leaders, y'all, sitting in this room, under 25, you know, or barely 25. But I said to Kevin, Bobby has to be studied. Bobby, Irish American, Roman Catholic, privileged. The Kennedys are considered royalty in this country. He goes to South Africa in 1966 and uses the term white supremacy. Are y'all with me out there? Bobby's out there with Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta, you know, Chicano, Mexican American farmers. Bobby's out there also talking about poverty, talking about the abuse, the violence of poverty. And Bobby, as y'all know, when Dr. King was killed, gave probably one of the greatest speeches in American history in Indianapolis, Indiana. No notes. All black people basically out there. Indianapolis that night was one of the only cities that did not explode because of the words of Bobby Kennedy. And so when I think about fatherhood, I think about manhood. For me, as someone who mentors and helps and tries to be a as good a role model as I can, even with all my imperfections, I have many imperfections, many, ask my wife, she'll tell you I have many imperfections. But I think about how these men, Bobby and Martin, did what all of us in this room can do, who are fathers, who are men. Find something greater in yourself that you can pull out of yourself. We need healthy manhood. We need healthy fatherhood. We need healthy manhood, we need healthy fatherhood. What does that mean? What does that look like? For me now, at this stage in my life, it means that we need to practice love, we need to practice peace, we need to practice nonviolence. It means that we need to respect women and girls as our equals, our equals, our equals, our equals, our equals, because women and girls are our equals, our equals, our equals, our equals. Are y'all with me out there? What does that mean? It means that we cannot engage in behavior. And we gotta stop acting like Donald Trump is some sort of aberration. He's actually just loud. He's just very loud. He's just very loud. But this is not abnormal. Ego, senseless competition, lack of preparedness for life. You know what I mean? Sense of entitlement. Everything is in violent imagery. Are y'all with me out there? There's so many of us who engage in this kind of behavior, and I'm saying that we've got to turn fatherhood and manhood in a different direction. And I'm saying to you all, we've got to think about how we relate to each other. You know, Ben will tell you, he worked with me as an intern years back. You know, we try to create a space when I work with people of any background, but think about young men for a second, like, this is a space where you can talk, where we're gonna listen, where we can open up, where we can share. If you need to cry, you can cry, and there's nothing wrong with crying. Am I right, y'all? You know, That's what I think about when I think about Father's Day, like in manhood, like, you know, can we create a new paradigm for what fatherhood looks like? I can't get my father back. The last chapter of my autobiography, The Education of Kevin Powell, is called Finding My Father. I found out 5-6 years ago, he died in 2001, 2002. I had no idea. In South Carolina, God bless you. I found out that he had been asking for me from some of the other folks that are my quote-unquote sisters and brothers. I don't know these folks, to be honest with you. I don't know them. I consider myself an only child. I found out that they knew that there was a child up north, but no one ever bothered to contact me. And even in the funeral bulletin that they gave me when I made a trip down to find my father's gravesite in 2013, my name wasn't even listed in the funeral under all the child. I was the only child that was not even listed. You know what I'm saying? And so you can imagine when I found my father's gravesite before I met all these relatives, and it was a long search through the cemetery. When I finally found his gravesite, I dropped to my knees and I just started crying. And you know what I said to him? I forgive you. Because I said to myself, you've got to be the father and the man that you wish your father could have been. And I had to let go all the pain. I've been carrying around all those years, you know? And so I say to the fathers out there who are here, who are going to listen to this, the men out there, love, man. You got to express love. If you don't know how to express love, figure it out. There's plenty of books out there. There's plenty of people to look up with names like Jackson Katz and Michael Kimmel and Byron Hurt and Quentin Walcott. There's brother Coach Dave, look him up online. You know, look up Bell Hooks, look up Eve Ensler. These are women who have experienced horrific abuse at the hands of women, of men, by men. I'm talking about Bell Hooks and Eve Ensler. But one of the things that has struck me about both Eve and Bell, they still have a profound love and hope for men, for fathers. Y'all with me? And so that's where I will end as well. In spite of all that I've laid out here, what keeps me going every single day is that I have a profound hope for our society, our nation, for this world. When we were singing that song, I mean, that song is just like John Lennon's Imagine. We have to have an imagination and not just say what's wrong with the world, we also, how can we fix and heal this world? And that's what I say to you all. Thank you so much for your time. I love you and I appreciate you. Thank you.